Well, good morning, everyone. It's nice to see you all here today. Nice to see some old faces back again, too. Some of them have been away for a long time. Good to see you, Barbara. And Owen and Linda, good to see you, too. And Bill. Goodness, we've got half the Uniting Church here this morning. This is good.
Really uniting.
Yeah, it is uniting, yeah. Tanya and Nick, good to see you back on the island again too. Are you here for a while?
Yeah.
Good.
2 weeks.
2 weeks. Longer.
Always 1 week.
Oh, good on you. Yeah. And Joshua and Ruth and Caleb and Hadessa, it's nice to have you folks back too. You remember, folks? When were you here last?
2020 November.
November, was it? 2020. Yeah. So. 18 months ago, give or take. Joshua was a, what do they call you, locum? Intern locum? Anyway, it's locum plus this time, so he's here for a longer period than just a locum period, so it's nice to have you and your family here with us. Darcel, good to see you. Darcel heads out on the flight next Saturday with us. We're headed off for a fortnight. John and Flo, good to see you over there too. Nice to have you along with us. And everybody else, have I missed any of you? If you're important and I've missed you, put your hand up. Shirley, you should have your hand up. Yes, it's good to see you here too.
I was only in hospital for 3 days.
Only 3 days. Good on you. It's good to see you up and about and over here as well. Paula, good to see you too. Where are you? Oh, there you are at the back. Dad and Dave are in Brisbane, probably attending a church. They were going to try and get to a church today. Dad's just gone over for a quick checkup on his operation, and that happens Monday, and they fly back on Tuesday. Just moving into the announcements, offering today is for the Warunga Scholarship, and we don't have a DVD, do we? So. He didn't send one this time for whatever reason, but anyway, that's where the offering's going towards today. After the church service, there is a lunch. Please plan to stay for that and stay for it. I saw out there before and the food looks delectable and delicious and more than enough for you, Nick. Good. Upcoming dates, there's an Easter service on the 16th of April, that's Easter Saturday, and an afternoon music program. Should I say that, what's his name? Yeah, Rick Foray and Trent. Well, Rick Foray is returning to Norfolk for a short period, and so they'll put on a musical program Saturday afternoon. You'll have more details as the time approaches, so that's something to look forward to. A week later, on the 23rd of April, we have a baby dedication. Young Joshua, isn't it, will be dedicated. That's Elvie and Rob's daughter, so that's something special for our church. Again, son, did I say daughter? I'm sorry. I was prophesying the next one. And on the 30th, the President, Pastor Alba Matahati, will be over for the long weekend by the sound of it, so he'll be taking that service, and there'll be a church lunch on that day as well. Those on the planning committee, and that is all the elders, the head deacon, head deaconess, Di and Julie, if you would come along at 4 p.m. this afternoon, we'll have a planning session for the next quarter. We've got a prayer meeting again this Tuesday at 7:15. Now, one other announcement. Please listen, because I will only say this once. The 4 TV channels which we had to pull off the air earlier are going back on the air. We had a flurry of emails late yesterday afternoon.
I'd stop praying.
But obviously,
the praying helped.
Yeah, well, I hope it helped. So if you've been praying, thank you very much. John.
You have Rob Waterston, son-in-law,
Oh, okay. Leighton, yes. I might have a word with Leighton too. Tell him to ask. No, anyway. So, that is good news. Don't try this afternoon. It's not up that quick. It takes a while to get things back up and running again, but we are going to put the four channels back up and running, and for that we need to praise God. He's been very faithful to us. Yeah.
And thank you.
Oh, don't thank me. Thank Gary.
Yeah. Thank you, Gary.
All right.
Well, what exciting news that is. That really is exciting news, isn't it? And it adds to our delight in being here this morning. Just being able to wake up this morning and to sense the beauty of the place and to know that this is God's creation, God's day. He really does want his children to be happy. So let's open our eyes this Sabbath, notice the beauty, and pray and not forget to give thanks to him for all that we are experiencing. I'm going to read to you from... No, I'm not. I'm going to ask for it to come up on the screen. Maybe not. Huh? Oh, the service. We're going to be reading a scripture together anyway, which will, I think, help to lift us into the presence of God. Because let's remember always that we do come here not only to meet together, which is a delight, and I do appreciate the way our senior elder is able to facilitate our feeling of togetherness in his announcements. First off, we are also here to direct our thoughts together to the Lord, aren't we? So let me just read to you from Psalm 63, which says this: O God, you are my God. Early I will seek you, for my soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and a bit thirsty land where there is no water. Because your loving kindness is better than life, my lips will praise you. And thus I will bless you while I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul will be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth will praise you with joyful lips. I trust that that will be our experience as we allow our hunger for God to draw us toward him. I wonder if you'd like then to sing with us our invitation song, Come Holy Spirit, and I invite you to stand for this. Stand, yes, we kneel in your presence, hungering for you, Heavenly Father, for we know that the land we walk in week by week is dry and barren without you. So, Father, please come by your Spirit this morning. May his voice in our hearts make our souls alive, we pray, please, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to invite those who are leading us in our praise and our worship to come forward now, and we'll lift our hearts in song.
Our first hymn this morning. Thank you.
One is covered with his life. So beautiful to be able to up here singing with all this lovely music. Thank you, one and all.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I enjoyed that. It sounds very nice up in that corner. Sorry for you folks down here, but yeah. Would you like to bow or kneel with me as we talk to God in prayer? Now, Father in heaven, it is really good to be able to draw nearer and still nearer to you, to be able to come into your house of worship this morning and spend time with you. We thank you that before we arrived, your Holy Spirit and angels were already here, ready to greet us, and we thank you for that. And I pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit especially won't be just a external presence of yours, but will actually become, will come and dwell deeply within, as you have promised in your word. And I pray, Lord, that as we listen to what Roger has prepared for us today, that your word will be used by Roger, and your word will find a resting place in each of our hearts. But not just to rest, dear Father, we pray that it may activate our lives, that it may direct our lives, that our lives may indeed more closely represent you and the love and sacrifice that you have demonstrated for each of us. We're conscious, Lord, that in this world things are not very nice. We listen to the news, we watch it on the TV, and it's a sad, sad place. We think especially this morning, Lord, for the many displaced people, not only from Ukraine, but so many other war-torn countries around the world. And it's just hard to know, it's hard even to comprehend the scale of what's going on. And yet, Father, for you, you know the number of hairs on each head that is involved. And we know that you love each one inestimably. And so, Father, I pray that not because of who we are here praying this prayer, but because of who you are that answers the prayers, that you will meet the needs of these people, their soul needs especially, Lord, that in this time of heartache and distress and displacement, that their minds may indeed turn to you, and that as their minds turn to you, Lord, you will fill that gap in their lives, that they may become conscious of your presence, whether that be through the aid workers, through the different agencies that minister on their behalf, whatever it is, Father, just help them to remember that you still are alive and well, you still are in control of the affairs of this world, and we need but just trust in that. We pray, Father, for those who are not with us today. We think of Dad and David and Kath and others, Lord. We pray that you will watch over them today, as they head off to a different church today, as they are able, that you will bless them. But regardless of where they are, Father, that you will draw near to them and that they will enjoy this day with you. So, Father, we ask that you will lock us in now with your love and with your presence, that at the end of this day we may be able to look back and say it's been a day well spent with you. We pray, please, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our offering this morning is for the Wurunga scholarships, and basically for families who would like to send their children to an Adventist school, and in this case the Wurunga Adventist school in North Sydney. Needy families are able to apply for scholarships to assist with their school fees, and this is where your offering is going towards today. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Our Father, we give back to you our tithes and offerings this morning in recognition of all that you have given to us, both temporal and spiritual. And especially, Father, for the families that will benefit from these scholarships, I pray that they will be blessed and that you'll watch over them in Jesus' name. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 462, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Privilege to stand before you and to be with you this morning. I often think that we take for granted the privilege of being able to be exposed to the very Word of God. I trust that will be our privilege this morning. We have, in the last number of weeks, been going through a series in the latter part of the book of Matthew, which I have entitled Crucified, Profiles of Cowardice and Courage in the Shadow of the Cross. Don't take any notice of what you're seeing on the screen. I'm going to be taking another of those passages this morning where we will look at Christ facing, or Christ on trial. And we will be looking at that story in Matthew chapter 26 shortly. But just let me make a comment or two first of all, that as I was growing up, I so remember the tranquility, the peacefulness, if you like, the unthreatenedness of life in the northern suburbs of Wurunga, how carefree it was. The bushland was beautiful, the neighbourhood was benign, you could walk on the streets, you could run around until after dark. It was a very happy and safe place. And to be a citizen was a very highly respected thing, and to be a Christian was very highly respected as well. But I don't think it takes very much television watching, for example, to notice that things have changed a lot. You have been seeing the programs on television that malign Christians quite often. I was quite struck with this quotation during the week from a commentary that I was reading, where it says that the church in the modern West has until recently enjoyed a privileged status as a positive force for personal and social welfare. Yes. That approbation is waning, he says. Indeed, Christianity is often maligned, as often maligned as it is applauded. What the future holds, we cannot say. But it is not difficult to imagine the church finding itself in a situation similar to its infant years, in which Jesus is looked on as a malefactor rather than a benefactor. If so, the church will be called on to learn afresh the meaning of following one who was numbered with the transgressors. It isn't only Christians who are on trial, however. It's the very faith that Christians hold. Once again, as you watch Q&A, or you listen to the news, or you see gay rights applauded, you realize that Christian values are being increasingly treated as hostile to the good of society. Not only ideas, but we ourselves are troubled by that. We've all been watching Ukraine this week. We've been seeing images of babies being born in basements while there was a relentless shelling of Russian mortar attacks overhead. We've watched buildings as smoking skeletons. We've seen refugees and heard their tearful stories. And who of us is so callous as to be able to watch that and resist the question, oh my God, where have you gone? Very often, I think we understand what the psalmist says in Psalm 42 and verse 2. My tears have been my food day and night as they say to me every day, where is your God? Christians and the Christian faith is on trial today as never before. And for that reason, I think that our subject this morning, Jesus on trial before the Sanhedrin, will have something to teach us. We will notice, first of all, how Jesus bore up under trial. And secondly, we will notice how Christians are to bear up under similar trial, under similar pressure. But first of all, let's see the story afresh as it's acted out on the DVD. Thank you very much.
Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death. But they did not find any, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward and declared,
"This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days.'"
Then the high priest stood up and said to Jesus,
"Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?"
But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said to him,
"I charge you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God."
"Yes, it is as you say,"
Jesus replied.
"But I say to all of you,
in the future you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
"He's worthy of death,"
they answered. Then they spit in his face and struck him with their fists. Others slapped him and said,
"Prophesy to us, Christ. Who hit you?"
Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him.
Let's bow our heads. Our Father, you have not let us alone in the dark. You've given us light through your word and through your Son. And we ask this morning, Father, that that light might shine into the corners of our souls and burn there brightly and enable us to live to your glory. We ask it, please, in Jesus' name. Amen. The story you've just seen is found in Matthew chapter 26, verse 57 down to verse 68. And as I always do, I like to invite you to turn your Bibles to that particular place. As we notice this particular story in two sections, I'm going to be looking at it, first of all, under this heading, Christ on Trial, looking at the story itself. And then I want to think about Christians on trial. What implications does the trial of Jesus have for the way we live our Christian lives? So first of all, Christ on trial. And you'll notice the scene there was a scene which is described in verse 57, where it says, "Those who had laid hold of Jesus led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled." As I imagine the scene, and I don't think the movie was quite able to capture it, it was a solemn scene. The entire Sanhedrin was present. That's 70 people, 70 of the cream of the cream of the Jewish nation. There were the high priestly class, the high priest himself, former high priests, the commander of the temple guard, three of the treasurers of the temple were there. There was another class though, and that was the elders. I guess they're a little bit like our council of elders here. They were, maybe not, I was going to say they were wealthy landowners. At least they were lay people, business people, people of influence in the community who were not of the church class. And then there was a third class called the scribes, who were simply lawyers of the law, and who were basically of the middle class, and they were Pharisees by conviction. It was this group that had met to pass judgment on Jesus, and they were presided over by the man who on the film was portrayed, I think, rather chillingly, a man by the name of Caiaphas. Now, as I've researched Caiaphas a little bit, I've discovered that he was a man of no mean ability. He was so good as a diplomat, as an administrator, that he lasted in that priestly office for 19 years, which was at least 10 years longer than anybody else. In other words, he was a very clever manipulator. But there was something else that comes to light about this man, Caiaphas. Not only was he extremely gifted, but he was profoundly insecure. You see, in his high priesthood, he was continually under the shadow of his father-in-law, a man by the name of Annas. Annas was the acknowledged head of the high priestly family. He was of age, but his voice, his opinion, his counsel on things was prized by the Jewish people as though it was the very voice of God. But not only was he under the shadow of Annas, in recent years he had come under the shadow of the man of Galilee. Caiaphas was very aware that the people were following Jesus, that they were applauding Jesus, that they were hanging off his every word. And as Ellen White puts it, a bitter, bitter jealousy arose in his heart. So this was a driven career man who, with all of his ability and success, was profoundly insecure, and he hated the feeling. It drove him to be, as the Gospels point out, an extremely expedient man. By that I mean a man who didn't care for principle, it was whether it worked that mattered. Expedient. He wasn't the only one. He was part of a culture. The Jewish faith had deteriorated to the place where appearance was much more important than character. Do you remember Jesus speaking of those who went out onto the street corners and prayed so that they could be seen by men? And he spoke of people giving charitable gifts with the announcement of a trumpet so that they could be, in his words, seen by men. Caiaphas was part of a culture where it was more important to look good than to be good. They had missed the teaching of Jesus, who on one occasion in John chapter 4 and verse 44 says, "How can you believe," he said, "you who receive honor from one another and do not seek the honor that comes from the only God?" Or the danger, my friend, the danger of allowing my soul to be more concerned about what people are thinking of me rather than what the Almighty God is thinking of me. Clever, insecure, unprincipled, a profile of evil. What a confrontation that Jesus would be led from Gethsemane into the court of Caiaphas, who, as it goes on to say, was bent to put him to death. I can imagine the atmosphere that night. An atmosphere of tension. They had been plotting to get Jesus for months. There had been councils. There had been backroom conferences. There had been spies. And finally they had him in their clutches. It was very important that this night, before the sun got up, they would accuse him and have him crucified. But there was something that was going to prevent that. It was the nature of the Sanhedrin themselves. The Sanhedrin was a deeply divided group. Just as churches are today, with liberal theology and conservative theology. These two Sadducees and Pharisees that made up the making of the Sanhedrin were at each other's throats, looking every moment for some way to put the other one down. So there were some things you just couldn't talk about there. They could have brought before the council any number of charges about Jesus denouncing the hypocrisy of the scribes and Pharisees. But if he'd done that, why, the Sadducees would have said, good on you, Jesus. They could have said, he could have brought forth any number of charges where Jesus had spoken against tradition. But once again, the Sadducees would have been applauding him. It was a very tense and delicate thing that he was doing to try to work his way through all of those tensions. But he was determined. And verse 58 has a very chilling phrase in it. In verse 59, it says, the chief priests, the elders, and all the council sought false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death. That's chilling, isn't it? When you think of who these people were, sitting in council that night. They were not neo-Nazis. They were not mad Bolsheviks or crazed terrorists. These were church-going, synagogue-attending, Sabbath-keeping Christians, in quotes, or God-fearing men. These were people who were applauded by everyone who saw them as paragons of virtue and righteousness. They were well thought of. But deep inside was a hatred for the one who stood for righteousness and virtue. They hated him. And it says here that they were willing to seek false testimony in order to put him to death. You have to wonder that it had come to that. But as you read the Gospels, particularly the Gospel of John, you discover that one of the themes that John has is the slow but inevitable deterioration, the moral, spiritual deterioration of Jesus' enemies. Right from the beginning, Jesus has enemies, people who were convicted by what he was saying, but were saying, I don't think though that this is going to cost me too much. And they'd be convicted again. And they'd be saying, no, that'll cost me too much. The Bible actually says that many of the people who were sitting in that Sanhedrin had been so convicted by the teaching of Jesus that it was pure, that it was true, that it was right, that it was what they should do, that they were ready to follow him. But it would cost them too much. On one occasion, Jesus addressed that very issue. John chapter 7, He confronts the tendency of people to not listen to their conscience. John chapter 7. Verse 12, it says, there was much complaining among the people concerning him. And some were saying, well, he's good. Others said, no, on the contrary, he deceives the people. And Jesus responded to that by saying, if anyone wills to do my will, he will know concerning the doctrine whether it is from God or whether I speak on my own authority. If anybody chooses to do my will. What had been happening for those people as they listened to Jesus? Was there a motive in their hearts where they said, whatever God wants is what I must do, cost what it may? Ellen White has this comment in the book Desire of Ages. Man's advantages for obtaining a knowledge of the truth. Notice that. Man's advantages for obtaining a knowledge of the truth. It means the ability to come to church. It means intellect. It means books that you can read. It means education. It means all sorts of things. Man's advantages for obtaining a knowledge of the truth, however great these may be, will prove of no benefit to him unless the heart is open to receive the truth and there is a conscientious surrender of every habit and practice that is opposed to its principles. To those who thus yield themselves to God, having an honest desire to know and to do his will, the truth is revealed as the power of God for their salvation. But the Pharisees had not put their will on the side of God's will. They were not seeking to know the truth, but rather to find some excuse for evading it. Our passage tells us that they were seeking false testimony in order to put Jesus to death. It's interesting also to notice that in this trial they showed a fastidiousness which is so characteristic of evil. Did you notice that they sought false testimony to put, against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none? The background of that is that the Bible says and the law said that unless you had two witnesses who agreed in every detail, those witnesses were not counted. The witness of those two witnesses had to be unanimous in every trivial aspect or it was thrown out. Think about that for a moment, folk. Think about the fact that these Pharisees, these religious people, were so determined to be honest about that, and yet, deep in their souls, they were not willing to be honest about principle. How often that has been true of people over the years. Fastidious about keeping the letter of the law, but careless about the principles involved. At last, in verse 60, it says, at last two witnesses came forward. And they said, this fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple and to build it again in 3 days. it's very interesting to notice that the method of hell has always been the same. Mostly truth, but a little bit of error that destroys the whole. Satan tried it on Jesus, his second temptation. He quotes from Psalm 90 exactly, except for one phrase which made the quotation mean something entirely different. And here, through the witnesses, he did exactly the same thing. Did Jesus actually say, "I am able to destroy the temple of God and build it in 3 days"? John chapter 2 describes the fact that Jesus said something very similar, but not the same. He did not say, "I will destroy the temple and then rebuild it in 3 days." He said, "Destroy, you may destroy this temple, my body, but after 3 days I will raise it again." A very, very different thing. But that, as I say, has been the method of hell forever. Mostly truth, but a little bit of error. May God help us as we read his word to read it carefully and to read it completely. Verse 63, I discover that verse 62, the high priest stands up at this point. I see Caiaphas boiling over with frustration, sheer frustration. He stands up and he seizes on this particular testimony and he says, "Do you answer nothing? What is it that these men are testifying against you?" But Jesus keeps silent. And then the high priest answers and says to him, "I put you on oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." Why was it that Jesus could keep silent for so long, but when he is put on oath, he speaks clearly, "Yes, I am who you say I am"? You remember Jesus himself spoke about this to his followers. In Mark chapter 8, he said, "Whoever desires to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his own soul? And what will a man give in exchange for his soul?" And then this, "Whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels." It's a solemn thing, isn't it? Jesus is there saying clearly to those of us who follow him, if in this sinful and adulterous generation in which we live, we find ourselves shrinking back from saying, "Yes, I belong to Jesus," if by our silence at the right moment or the wrong moment we betray him, Jesus says, "Him will I deny before my Father who is in heaven." There was a time for silence. When the nonsense was going on about false testimony, which was obviously nonsense, Jesus did not give in to the temptation to try to defend himself. Silence was golden. Silence was powerful. But when it came to acknowledging that he was who he said he was, he did what he asked his disciples to do, at the risk of great loss. Jesus' answer, it is as you say. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. I want to focus for just a moment on that as we close. Here is the Lord Jesus saying, yes, you are right, I am the Christ. And I can just imagine the scorn in the eyes of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and particularly the scorn in the eyes of Caiaphas. You, Jesus, standing here in your weakness, bound as you are, your disciples have left you. You claim to be the Messiah of God, the one that we expected would simply speak and vast armies would be destroyed. You and your weakness claim to be that? And Jesus looks back at him and says, nevertheless, Caiaphas, the day is coming when I, who am now so weak, will come in the power and the glory of the Son of God, of God himself. I want to close by drawing two brief lessons from this story. Christians are on trial all the time. Increasingly so. How are we to behave? How are we to witness to our faith? We are to do exactly what Jesus did. We are to be silent when silence is required. Did you notice that the very man who watched all this happen, the Apostle Peter, wrote to his parishioners in 1 Peter chapter 3 about that very silence? He says in 1 Peter chapter 3, what credit is it to you when you are beaten for your faults and you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. To suffer and to not speak back is a great witness for Jesus, for that's exactly what Jesus did. That's a powerful thing. But there's something else. And with this, I will finish, I promise. How are we to deal with the chilling scenes that we see so often on television and we have been inundated with in recent weeks? How are we to deal with these scenes which apparently show an impotent God? How can God allow Russian shells to fall out of the sky 24/7 continually on helpless people? How can he do that? How can he allow the suffering and the pain and why does God not stand up as the Jews wanted the Messiah to do? Why does he not do it? And Satan takes advantage of that in the dark moments of our lives. Where is your God? He says, as he said so often to the psalmists. The answer, I believe, lies in that picture of Jesus. Silent in the midst of abuse. If only Jesus that night had declared himself to be the Son of God with power, the disciples who were terrified would have been rescued. The suffering that he went through would never have happened. But he did nothing. When I look into the stars at night, I'm reminded that that same God is on the throne tonight. That same Jesus that held his peace in the Sanhedrin is holding his peace at the moment. But he will speak, because Jesus ended up saying, "Nevertheless, you will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven and sitting on the right hand of power. You will." Let's never remember that the God whom we are waiting for is that same Jesus who held back his power for a greater purpose. He's holding back his power now for a greater purpose, but he will come. Let's suffer with him until he does, is my prayer in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Roger. Let's close our time of worship now, and we will sing hymn 331, "O Jesus, I Have Promised."
Join with me as we pray. Now, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God, who is our Saviour and who alone is wise, to him be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.